Pattern classification. Why should patterns be classified? Now, this is a question that you can ask. What is the need to classify patterns? The need to classify patterns comes out of the humongous amount of patterns that we have today. US, the United States Patent Office has granted more than 9 million patents, and patenting has been in vogue for quite many years. So we require a system by which it is easier to look for patents and to search for patents. So the system by which we look for patents, we had already mentioned that there is patents. We know that something is a patentable invention when you compare it with the prior art. So to understand the prior art, and because we have so many granted patents, we need a system of classification. Now the classification is a system of codes that are used to identify inventions. Inventions fall within, as we have already mentioned, broad streams of technology, but invention in itself will fall under some category or some subcategory. So the classification is to place an invention in the context of broader technologies and fields of technologies. Now the classification is indispensable for retrieving information on patents when you do a prior art search. So let's imagine a world without classification. Then the only way we will be able to look at patent prior art is by looking for things using words. You know, we find some key search terms and we search for those terms. That is not the best way to look for prior art. Prior art, because it is codified and it is classified, we use classification codes to search for prior art. Now, there are multiple international classifications. It may sound a bit confusing for starters, but this is a place which you can easily navigate because today we have technology which helps you to search for these things. We also have cross-reference from one classification to another. Now, the reason we have multiple classification is the fact that we had patent law developed in US, United States, in a particular format, and you had patent law developed in Europe in a form that was different from what was in Europe. So the US practice got codified and the US Patent Office used certain codes for classifying inventions. The codes that the European office used were different. So at some point they came together, created common codes, started using common codes, and now we have broadly two classifications, if you can put it that way, but all the other classifications have now kind of been consolidated. So WIPO, that is the World Intellectual Property Organization, is the main organization which deals with intellectual property rights, and WIPO has its own classification, which we will soon see, is called the IPC classification, IPC. Now, WIPO not only has classification for patents, it also have classifications to facilitate search of information concerning invention, trademark, industrial designs. So it, the ambit of WIPO is much bigger than patents itself. Now, different types of classification. You have the ECLA, which is a European classification system. This has now been replaced by the Cooperative Patent Classification System, now CPC, in eSpaceNet. We already had a look at how the eSpaceNet looks. Now, so the European classification system has now moved to the CPC. Okay, we'll come to what this is, what CPC is. Just to tell you that different patent offices evolved different systems of classifications, and now they are all moving towards a uniform system. USPC, United States, which has more than 100 years history in classification, started off with something called the USPC, which was the United States Patent Classification System, but they moved to the CPC again, the Cooperative Patent Classification. So now this classification is jointly developed and run by the US Patent Office and the EPO. And that brings us to the CPC, which is the classification system jointly developed and run by the USPTO and the EPO. Now, this is an outcome of an ambitious harmonization effort to bring the best practices of each office. So today, US Patent Office and the EPO follow the CPC system. And finally, we have the IPC system. Now, we will start with the IPC system because the IPC system divides technology into 8 sections with approximately 70,000 subdivisions. So you should understand the ambit of a classification. Regardless of what you can think of, will fit into one of these 70,000 subdivisions. You name the invention, there is a category under which it will fall in. So it has got 8 broad sections. We will have a look at that. And then you have 70,000 subdivisions. Almost anything and everything imaginable falls into some subdivision or the other. Now let's have a look at the classification system itself. This, you are now at the WIPO homepage. Now the WIPO has an international classification page, and from there you can go on to the international patent classification. Now this is how it looks. Now in the international patent classification, you can access the international patent classification, that is the IPC. This is how the IPC looks. Now these are the 8 codes or 8 sections: human necessities, performing operations, transporting, chemistry, metallurgy, textiles, paper, fixed constructions, mechanical engineering, physics, electricity. Very, very broad classification, but the entire world is within these classification. More than, as you just saw, more than 70,000 subdivisions are there. Now, how do the subdivisions look like? All you need to do is just click here, okay? Or here. Now it just expands. Now, this will give you the codes. What is important here is to look at the codes. Now, B01D is a code. B03B is another code. These are all codes for different categories of inventions. So anything that you can think of will come under this code. Now, does that mean that this entire thing of classification is codified, right? Today we have the IPC and broadly the CPC. Now, recently, the IPC, this is the WIPO, has also introduced a CPC code. Can you see here? This is the CPC code onto the left-hand side of your screen. So you could also click on this when you search and it will give you corresponding CPC code. So there is some kind of measure by which there is harmonization and cross-reference to these codes. We'll just look at a quick example where this is put into practice. Now, the international patent classification, there is some write-up on this. You can get some information from the links that have been provided below. And to make sense of how these classifications work together, you can go to the uspto.gov website, where you have a nice write-up on the classification standards and development. So you have the CPC mentioned there. You have the USPC mentioned there. Now, they largely follow the CPC now. And you also have the IPC. So this is a great source of information as to how these things developed and what is the implication. Now, under the US Patent Office, USPC, you will find a link where it will give you a search strategy. Now, this is a document which you can refer to and look at it in some detail. It gives you strategies on search, brainstorm terms describing your invention, access and review cooperative patent classification CPC schema using USPTO's website. Then they give you the steps and how to do it. So this will be a great source for those who want to look at search in some great detail. And the US, you will find the 7-step strategy under the USPC section here. Now, let's just try our hands on some search. Now, we can come back to this place. This is the WIPO page. And let us just look for cricket bat. I'm just going to search cricket bat here. And when I search cricket bat onto your left-hand side of your screen, I get all the codes under which cricket bat could be mentioned. So I'll just click on the first code so that you get to see this. There it is. So it says A63B 102/20 is cricket, and 20 is a code which also has other codes. A62B also has application of clubs. That's a broader category. Now this comes under A63B, the general code, which is apparatus for physical training, gymnast, swimming, climbing, ball games. So, and this comes under A63, which is the broad category of sports, games, and assumptions, which comes under A, which is human necessities. So now, regardless of what invention you are looking at, you will now be able to find the classification code for it. And when you search for inventions, you can either look for related patterns within that invention, like what a Google pattern search will throw, or you could look for this code, because now you know every cricket bat that is claimed ever should have used for this game cricket, they should have used this code, or they should have at least used A62B. So A62B, you could search by the code and find all the relevant prior art. Okay, now how these different classification systems compare? We just have a screenshot of what you just saw in the US Patent Office website. So things to note, patent classifications are the best way to look for the prior art. Doing a keyword search may help, but that's not the best way. You need to get to some classification code to traverse the prior art. And there are different patterns of classification.